Well, did you guess? I've had a request and we are making monkey bread. For those of you who don't know what monkey bread is or possibly call it something other than monkey bread, it's basically little balls of dough that you sweeten up in some way and layer in some kind of a pan and bake it, and you just pull off the little balls of goodness and eat them. It's just a break apart kind of, it's a dessert. So it's not really a bread, it's a dessert, and you don't slice it, you pull at it. It's fun. So I had a request for this, that's what I'm doing. But wait, because I have some baking jokes. Don't worry, they're not long. Why don't bakers trade recipes? Because they need their own. What do you get when you cross a baker and a procrastinator? A half-baked idea. Okay, these are really dumb, but I have one more. This is my favorite. I used to be a baker, but I couldn't make enough dough. Okay, anyway, that's just something to lighten the mood in case you're starting this video and thinking, ugh. Anyway, so fun. All right. Oh, I just realized I didn't get one of my ingredients. I can get that in a minute. We're going to turn off the camera and I'm going to get that prepared. Be right back. If this is my first video that you've ever watched, beware. I am goofy and I am sloppy and messy and silly. My kitchen isn't neat as a pin. It's not dirty, but it's not like there's clutter. And I do all of my recipes in grams. I weigh them in grams. I develop them in grams. Yes, I grew up in the United States. No, I didn't grow up using grams. I grew up using measuring cups like most of you who will be watching this. But weighing your ingredients is more accurate. It will give you more consistent, good results with your breads. And most of all, if you're like me and lazy, it's so much faster and easier. If you haven't converted yet, look for my video that says how to convert going to measuring cups from grams. And if you need help with that, please go to my website, which I'll give you in a second, and go to the contact page, email me, and I will explain it to you, okay? Don't worry, I will explain everything. My website is ellensbreadmachinerecipes.com. And I think, do I have it on here? No. ellensbreadmachinerecipes.com. And you don't have to memorize that because under the video, when you're on YouTube, there will be a bolded word, more. And you click on more and the recipe will be below and also the link to my website. And you want to go to the website to actually get the recipe because that way you can find it in PDF format really easily and just print it out. Okay, or you can abandon this YouTube, go to ellensbreadmachinerecipes.com, search for monkey bread, you can do that too. I'm so easily found. All right, so for this monkey bread recipe, I'm going to use my tried and true master butter dough recipe. It's more the technique that is new to me and to you, not necessarily the ingredients. I'm not going to give you the amounts because you're going to read them in the recipe and I don't want you to try scrambling to write them down. There's no need to do that. But I am using half and half. You can also use full fat milk. I have a slightly beaten egg. And I'm just scraping in. Have everything measured ahead of time so I don't bore you with all that time for measuring or weighing or whatever. Okay, I'm gonna put in a splash of vanilla, which actually isn't in my recipe, but since I'm making something sweet, I'm not measuring that. Well, actually I want a little more than that because that was maybe only a quarter teaspoon. There we go. And in goes the bread flour. Most of my recipes are 2 pounders. This happens to be a 1.5 pounder. So if your machine goes up to 1.5 pounds, you don't have to reduce this recipe. And by the way, I have not learned how to do this, so don't ask me, but the way to reduce a recipe for a smaller capacity bread machine is to use something called baker's percentages. And if you Google that, it'll all be all over the place. There are calculators on the internet. You'll find it easily. I just haven't mastered it, so I can't teach you yet. All right, I'm putting in my sugar. And in my machine, I forgot to say that in my bread machine, it has a rest or a preheat at the beginning. So I don't need to warm up my liquids, put my butter at room temperature or softened or anything like that, because my machine warms the ingredients. If yours starts kneading from the second you press start, you have to warm those ingredients. Not the egg though, you don't warm egg, you just put it in room temperature. So I always put the flour on top of the liquids. This is how my bread machine work. Zojirushi Virtuoso Plus. So sugar goes on the right, salt goes on the left. This way I can see if I put it in. Like if the phone rings, I get interrupted, have to run to the bathroom, any of those things, I can look and see. I put in the sugar, I put in the salt. Now, for you on video, I have it all measured out because it just makes it go faster. But when I'm baking on my own, I don't always do that. Sometimes I do it when I'm making a new recipe, when I'm developing a new recipe. But when I'm making a tried and true, I don't bother to do that. I just throw it in one at a time. I don't pre-measure. I cut my butter into pieces and put it along the long sides of my baking pan. And I just want to make sure. I always go down the recipe before I put the yeast. Milk, yes. Egg, yes. Bread flour, yes. Sugar, yes. Salt, yes. Unsalted butter, yep. Yeast is coming up. So I make a little well in the bread pan for the yeast. And it's safely snuggled in. So in just a minute, we're going to turn off the camera. I'm going to put this in my bread machine and set it for dough. And my dough course or cycle, mine is called courses, your bread machine may call it a cycle. My dough course is number 11. If you have a Zo Virtuoso Plus, it's number 11. And what it does is it preheats. In my kitchen, it preheats for 23 minutes. And then it 5 minutes it kneads, and at 5 minutes there's no buzzer or ding or anything. I just set a timer. I set a timer for 28 minutes. That's 23 minutes preheat, 5 minutes of kneading. And after 5 minutes of kneading, I check the dough to see what the consistency is and make sure that I don't need to add either flour or liquid, because that happens at least 60% of the time for me, that I have to add one or more of the other. You cannot depend on the fact that, sorry, my phone is ringing, we're just gonna let that go. You cannot depend on the fact that once you measure the flour and such, that it's the same every time. You have to watch the dough 5 minutes into kneading every single time, because humidity changes. So earlier today, it was raining. Now, I have a gorgeous, gorgeous blue puffy cloud day, but we're trying to stop that phone call. Anyway, futile. Don't worry about it. We had a rainy day this morning, but now it's sunny, but that means that it's still going to be humid, so it may very well be that I have to add flour. So we're going to turn this off, turn the camera off, and I'm going to start the dough. And I'm going to check in with you at 5 minutes into kneading to see if my dough is just too wet, too dry, or just right. Well, I came back earlier than I said I was going to, because I realized I never finished talking about what the dough course was, because we were interrupted rudely by a stupid spam call. Anyway, you all get them. No one is a stranger to that. My dough course preheats, kneads, and I check it at 5 minutes. It rises, knocks it down, rises a little more, and then it completes. And that's when I take it out, form it however I want to form it, whether it's a loaf of bread or rolls or whatever. Like today I'm doing the monkey bread. And then I let it rise, and then it bakes in the oven. So I just wanted to explain what I kind of forgot to do because the phone call was interrupted. And when the phone rings, the videographer gets distracted. And when the videographer gets distracted, the baker gets distracted. So anyway, I already set my Apple Watch for a 28-minute timer. And again, that's 23 minutes of rest on my machine and 5 minutes of kneading, and then I check. See you then. So while I'm waiting for my machine to heat up and to start kneading, I'm gonna do some of the prep work. When the dough is finished, I'm going to make little blobs or balls or whatever you wanna call them, and I'm gonna roll them in, it'll be melted butter. So I'm gonna roll each dough ball melted butter. Then I'm gonna roll them in a mixture of cinnamon and sugar. So I don't need to mix the cinnamon and sugar in front of you. You all know what that is. And in fact, I think what I might do is put the lid on this plastic container and shake, shake, shake. And I'm going to bake the monkey bread in a bundt pan. Or if you've watched My Big Fat Greek Wedding anytime and you remember, it's a bundt, a bundt, a bundt. Oh, it's a cake. Anyway, if you remember that reference, we love that movie. So we quote it whenever we have lamb chops or leg of lamb, we say we're gonna eat vegetarian tonight because, you know, if you don't know the movie, forget it. But anyway, it's funny. So I'm gonna spray the bundt pan very, very well with my canola oil spray. And when the time comes, I will zap the butter in the microwave. I will have this all mixed up and I'll show you what to do then. It has been 28 minutes since I pressed the start button. On my machine, that's 23 minutes for that rest or preheat and 5 minutes of kneading. I have not peaked, so now we're going to see. Okay, I think it looks pretty good. Tacky, not sticky. Okay, there's no dough coming off of my hands. It's just tacky. It's formed a nice dough ball. We are good to go. So now I'm just going to close the lid, let it continue, and set an alarm. This is going to finish at 3:28 p.m. It is now 2:09. So I'm going to set an alarm on my phone for about 3:22, which gives me a few minutes to do my last minute preparations, which most of them I've done, but I have to melt the butter as I showed you earlier. Sorry for it's just the bread machine noise. There we go. I have 17 minutes to go. Just thought I would show you what this looked like. And it probably doesn't look to you like it rose very much. This is one of the recipes I have that actually rises more in baking than it does beforehand, but it will be perfect. I have a bread pan of dough that I'm going to dump out. Obviously, one of the paddles came out. I'm gonna do my little filling this with ditch detergent, just a drop, and a little bit of water. Oops. I just put water in enough to top the spindles. Okay, put that over there. We're all set. So I told you a minute ago that this dough doesn't rise tremendously until it's baked. I mean, it did rise, it doubled in size, but it's not like huge and puffy until it bakes. I have a little assembly line here. I have my dough. And I actually prefer working left to right, but the videographer is to my right, so that's what I'm going to do. I'm not going to weigh this and divide it by a certain number. I'm just kind of playing around. I'm just going to cut it kind of into ropes or whatever you want to call it. I'm not measuring anything. It doesn't need to be exact. That won't even matter. I'll just press it back in. Do it again. And this is a totally like you do how you do, you know, whatever you like, you do it that way. Whether you want to make the chunks or the balls or the globs of dough bigger, smaller, that is completely your choice. Okay? So what I'm going to do is just cut these and loosely roll. I'm going to stick a few in there at a time because I think it's just more time efficient. It's kind of fun. Then I'm going to grab a spoon. I guess I probably can just get them out with my fingertips. I just did exactly what my husband told me not to do, which was to be sloppy. All right, but I did it anyway. So now I'm just going to transfer these. I don't know how I'm going to be super neat doing this. I don't think there's a way. Okay, I'm just going to kind of roll them around. I may need to make a lot more cinnamon sugar, but we'll see. And then I'm going to transfer them, after I'm sure they're coated, into the bundt pan. And you can see that they're not all the same size. That is by design for two reasons. Reason number one, it's not necessary. Oops, there goes being neat. Reason number two, I'm too darn lazy to worry about it. Okay, we got a couple more over here. Stick those in there. Cut some more. Now, some of you are going to be perfectionists and want them all the same size. I think actually in this application, the cake might look prettier if they're not all the same size. But this is, again, a totally personal choice. I think we will turn off the camera so I can get more of this done, and I'll give you kind of a progress report in between of, you know, like maybe halfway through, and then again when I'm pretty much done, because, you know, a little boring to watch me do all of this. All right, so we will be back. So we've been, when my cameraman didn't have to hold the phone, he was helping me, so that made it go quite a bit faster. You can see that we've just been stacking them. No particular art form to it. Just try to maybe distribute them evenly. And I want you to see over here on the counter how different my sizes are. And I think that's really going to add to the monkey bread to make it look prettier if they're all different colors. I mean, they're all different. Well, they're not all different colors. All different sizes. So we're going to show you what it looks like when it's done and how to rise it. And also, I was thinking as I was playing in melted butter and cinnamon sugar that this is a really great baking project to do with your little kids or big kids or parents or aunts and uncles, cousins, brothers, or friends, because who wouldn't have fun rolling the dough, sticking it in butter, and rolling it in cinnamon sugar? I think this is a great project to do with your kids or friends or husbands, wives, whatevers. I think it would be a lot of fun. So we're just about finished here. I think I'm going to turn off the camera for just a moment while I honestly get my hands washed. We can talk some more. Make sure there's no dough balls hiding in here. Now we have to let this rise. It takes about 40, 45 minutes. It's supposed to double in size. You can cover this, leave it on your counter, and let it rise, but it might take a little longer, especially if your kitchen isn't pretty warm. In the summertime, if you don't use air conditioning and your kitchen is 75, 80 degrees, 85 degrees, probably be okay. We always run air conditioning when it's hot because I have no tolerance for heat whatsoever. So I always use my oven for rising or for my Breville countertop oven that's on the opposite side of the oven, but I don't think this would fit. Maybe, I don't know. So this is how I do it with my oven. If you have a proof on your oven, please just use the proof and set your timer for 40 minutes. My oven doesn't have one because it's older. So I set it for oven and put it on the lowest temperature I can put it on, which is 170. Hit start, set a timer for 1 minute. The reason we set a timer for only 1 minute, I don't know why it shows blinking on the video, but it doesn't show blinking when we look at it. The video sees what the eye doesn't see. But anyway, the 1 minute is just to slightly warm the oven. Please do not leave your oven on while the dough is rising. I know if you've watched my YouTubes before and you know I say this again and again and again, fast forward through if you're sick of it, I wouldn't blame you a bit. But you only want to have the oven on for 1 minute to just make it slightly warm. And what it feels like is if you're in your nice cool house and you go out on a warm summer day and it's about an 85 degree day, when you just instantly feel, oh, it's warmer, but it's not hot. You don't want it too hot because that will kill the yeast. So the warm just lets the yeast blossom. Remember like in the old days when we had to proof the yeast in warm water? There you go. Okay, so timer's off, hitting end, and I'm turning the oven off. I only used 1 minute of electricity, okay? And another thing is, I do not cover my dough if it's in the oven rising. If it's on your counter, you need to cover it. But if you're just rising in the oven, there are no drafts in there. There's no air blowing. It's not gonna cool down. It's not gonna dry out. I always do it this way. So I'm gonna set a timer for 40 minutes. It's really 45, but when I take this out of the oven to do a little glaze or egg wash, if I do that, I'm not even sure if I'm doing that yet. By the time I heat my oven, it's been rising the 45 to 50 minutes it needs to rise. So I will show you what this looks like when final rise is over. And now I'm gonna clean up my messy counter. Look, Ma, I grew. It has, excuse me, definitely risen. It's definitely puffy. And I'm trying now to decide whether, I guess I'm not gonna egg wash that because first of all, I'm gonna flip it over. There's no reason to egg wash or put anything on top because this is gonna be the bottom. And I'm hoping that it stays together. It may not, either way, it'll taste luscious. And I wanna talk to you a little bit about what I'm hopefully going to do if this does stay in one piece when I flip it over. I wanna have a little dip now. I don't think it'll really need a dip. It's going to be sweet and yummy no matter what. I could do a glaze like you would do with cinnamon rolls with powdered sugar, milk, and vanilla. But I was thinking it might be fun to have something to dip. You might want to use Nutella. I can't eat that because I'm allergic to nuts. I just happen to have something I hadn't opened until now. This is a company that I buy my chocolate candies from, Dean's Sweets. And this is Maine sea salt caramel sauce. And I had not opened it. I've had it for months. I just tasted it. It is like, I just want to sit and eat it with a spoon. It is unbelievably luscious. If you know anyone who has allergies to nuts, tree nuts or peanuts or coconut, this Dean's Sweets is your place to go. It is the best chocolate. And I mean, I buy their all kinds of chocolate from them. The best chocolate I have ever tasted in my life. If you're from Detroit, Michigan, you can dip it in slightly melted Sanders hot chocolate. You can dip it in nothing and just eat it. You could make a glaze to pour over the top after you've unmolded it. This is where you get to be creative. I'll show you what it looks like when it's baked. This is how much it's puffed up. It really grows when you bake it. I cannot tell you how hard I am trying to restrain myself right now for not, I just wanna
you know, reach in and grab and eat so bad. Anyway, excuse me. usually I take pans out of a loaf pan right away, but in this situation, I'm a little nervous about doing that. I want it to cool so it hopefully will stick together when I unmold it. So there it is. My camera's showing a little bit more yellow, but it really isn't yellow here. There, well, it still looks yellow, but it's definitely brown or whatever you want to call it, golden. It is not yellow, but my kitchen cupboards are yellow, and I think it just kind of reflects. So it is gorgeous. I can't wait. I'm starving. All right, I'll show you when I get it unmolded. I just put it in the oven. I don't think it'll be done in 30 minutes, but that's what I set the timer for. By the way, my oven beeps, and if I'm in here, or if I don't have the TV on, or if I'm not talking on the phone, I will hear the beep, but otherwise I won't. So I got these super obnoxious timers to set that are really loud, and no matter where I am in my house, I can hear them. I mean, my hearing is okay, but for some reason, sometimes I don't hear the oven. I don't hear the bread machine anymore either, unless I'm right in the room or don't have the TV on. So this is just a little tip, a cheapo extra timer, or set the timer on your phone or your Apple Watch if you have one or whatever. Just set the timer. I set it for 30 minutes to check it. I'm sure it won't be done by then.
Well, I had to be a little in the overdue mode because I insisted on putting a dip in the middle, and it did sort of start to break it apart. So be careful how big the dip you put in, or maybe you won't use a dip. Now for the absolutely horrible job of tasting. In the little ramekin, I think I showed you that I was going to use this Dean's Sweet Sea Salt Caramel Sauce. It's just one idea. You could do so many things, or you could do absolutely nothing. You could do a glaze like on a cinnamon roll, chocolate syrup, nothing at all, frosting, whipped cream. I mean, the sky's the limit. I could have drizzled something over this. But right now, as I said, I have the absolutely terrible job of tasting. It's very juicy. Oh, I can't fake that. Okay, I'm gonna put that piece down because I wanna dip one. I don't wanna put the one that I dipped in so that my family can try it. Where shall I choose? It's so much fun to just pick one. I'll pick one down here where it's starting to break. Okay. I cannot wait for this bite. Oh, okay. This is just so unbelievably sinful. It's ridiculous. A definite win, you guys. I've only made monkey bread once before. It's been like 6, 7, 8 years ago, and I followed a recipe. I don't even know what it was. And I actually wasn't that impressed. It was a little, to me, on the dry side. It wasn't as sweet and buttery and yummy. So, so good. You don't have to make it in the bundt. You could do it in a round pan. You could do it in a square pan or a rectangular pan. You could do it in cupcake tins and put like 2 or 3 in a cupcake tin. You could do, put them in mini loaf pans. I mean, you could do any number of things. Be creative, have fun. You will find this recipe on my website. I will, as soon as I post the video, I will get the recipe uploaded also. Just search for monkey bread. And website again, Ellen's Bread Machine Recipes.com. Ellen's redmachinerecipes.com. There's no hyphen, there's no apostrophe S in Ellen's because you can't use that in a URL. So ELLENS, redmachinerecipes.com. Should I say bon appetit?